If I were to define cutting edge technology, it's the technology that's just emerging. To me, it's, you know, most of us think of cutting edge technologies as the latest, you know, camera, latest gimmick that we can buy. But for me, it's really the science that is early enough, too early probably, to productize and making the transition between science and actual product. That's cutting edge for me. And, you know, it can be in climate science and how we're going to pull carbon out of the atmosphere, for example. That could be one example of that. It could be in artificial intelligence and figuring out how are we going to embed intelligence into the world around us and make it affordable and make it useful and make it helpful to humans as opposed to reductive. I think if we look at the next frontier that is extremely promising, and I think probably one of the most powerful opportunities right in front of us, is really bringing biology, computer science, chemistry, physics together in the area of health. Because what is now possible is really to understand, we're learning how molecules behave and we're applying artificial intelligence to learn that. And if we can do that at scale, we can solve really complex problems. We can understand immunology. We can understand how to create compounds and medicines to solve some of the, you know, world's most challenging disease problems. So I think decoding our own body and then our ability to then reprogram it is going to be one of the next frontiers. I'm really excited about that as the cutting edge tech. Technology will change everything in our life. It will change every company. Will be a technology first company. And we're seeing currently seeing that transition happening in reality. I think almost all disciplines are going to rely very heavily on technology, whether somebody is a writer or they are a scientist and a biologist. They're going to need technology to do their work, to accelerate their work. I think everything around us will be infused with it. And of course, there are positive, huge positives to it. And of course, we need to be mindful of the potential downsides. Sci-fi literature is very important because those writers and artists think outside of what technologists know they can do today. And then we have to be technologists. We have to actually make technology or science deliver on what design has imagined. And that's a very hard part, but it's very obviously important because without that, nothing is possible. And then business is critical because without business, whatever we invent is not going to take hold. It has to be viable economically. And at the end of the day, it also has to be responsible, and we have to make sure that it is possible from the policy standpoint. You know, if we think about, you know, more than 100 years ago now when we invented combustion engine and a car, you know, if we think about, you know, the famous quote, if I listened to my customers, I would build a better horse, right? That was design thinking outside of what is possible outside of today. I think the real risks we take are when we walk outside of our core expertise and we basically say, I'm going to try something very different, whether it's career-wise or even just different skill, build a different skill set. So I've taken those risks as well when I changed disciplines, when I moved countries, and I highly recommend them. There isn't one. I can't just point to one moment because I kept doing that. There's a moment in your work where you probably feel like, oh my God, I know this like the back of my hand. I really understand what I'm doing. I can teach everybody about that. If you wake me up in the middle of the night, I can tell you exactly what's going on. And that is the moment to take risk. I probably have coached more than like 100 women, more than 100 women in my career so far. And when I started, I didn't realize how important it is to have role models in life. And how important you feel that there is somebody who's gone and understands your challenges, has gone through them, and has made some headways in life. we are in a very challenging position, especially with women in computer science, where we're actually going backwards. We have fewer women entering computer science today than we've had 20 years ago. And I think it's really important for those women to not only have to see great achievements in the discipline, but having seen those achievements being done by other women like themselves. My biggest gratitude actually goes to women that came in front ahead of me. You know, we've had centuries of women doing amazing things and, you know, not being recognized very deeply for it. And without them, my life would not be possible. In fact, my life would be very, very different. Part of self is a model of the world that we live in. So we have to break out of it. And arts and design is one of the best ways to really think creatively and think imaginatively. And then using science and technology to realize that and to make that reality. So I think it's really important for us to keep interacting, working with, and co-creating with artists around us, because they can really help ideate and envision tomorrow. You know, if we talk about, you know, writers that were futurist writers, you know, 100, 200 years ago, Jules Verne, who was writing about submarines, you know, now these things are reality. these things are real. So I think taking these kind of creative moments seriously, I think is really important. And then integrating them into how we actually make technology and how do we actually make science work. So I think that's a big deal. But in order to do that, I think we need to create the atmosphere of very very creative team culture, but also very diverse. You know, a lot of times in technology companies, you have incredible scientists, a bunch of people with PhDs, let's say in computer science, not a single person who's coming from a different kind of discipline. I think it's really important to blend disciplines, to blend mindsets in order to inspire creativity. Talk about this life-work balance, time for self, time for family, time for thinking. We really need to acknowledge the role of technology in that because it can be both a positive and a negative. And I think we see a lot of the negative effects. As much as we potentially are more productive because we have all these digital tools, we see increase in cognitive load, we see potentially distress, dissatisfaction, and disruption. So I think as technology makers, we need to set as one of our goals to really reduce the cognitive load. And when we talk about helping people be more effective, is really about helping take away the noise, helping take away the disruption, and take away the menial tasks. Right now, we oftentimes serve technology rather than technology serving us. And I think what we have an opportunity to do now, especially with artificial intelligence, is to really have technology assist us rather than us drive technology. And with that, give us more time to do interesting things. And what could humanity do with free time? Hopefully use it for creativity, use it for innovation, inspiration, and joy because we have more time to interact with each other. It's fascinating to think 100 years ahead because we're accelerating so much. You know, if we're talking about you know, type 2 civilization, right? You know, in traveling through cosmos, you know, and going to different planets. You know, we got here pretty fast, and now we're moving even faster with everything that kind of the build up of the technology is extremely rapid. If you show the full cell phone to somebody 100 years ago, it would have been complete science fiction. It would have been magic. But you know, in the last 50 years, we've made tremendous progress. So I think we are going to continue to reinvent ourselves, our bodies. We're going to reinvent, of course, the silicon-based technology that we already have and mechanical-based technologies that we already have. And we're going to even reinvent Earth technology, how Earth behaves. Hopefully now we actually have enough understanding of the world that we live in to not direct it into negative, to a negative outcome. I have a lot of hope that we are now smart enough, smarter as humanity and as individuals to actually help navigate us into a positive direction, to bring Earth back to an equilibrium, to create AI in a way that is assistive and helpful to us as opposed to destructive, to fix health problems, you know, to solve diseases that we were never able to do before. So I think the medicine is going to completely change in the next 100 years for the better. So as long as we don't succumb to our, you know, lower nature, I think we have an incredible future in front of us. A lot of work to do to solve for the problems that we ourselves have created. But if we push through and if we solve them, I think we have incredible 100 years in front of us. I'm really excited to see as much of it as I can.